Welcome back, everyone. In this video, I'm going to share how I would learn to code if I were to restart from scratch all over again. I have been coding for almost 7 years, and on my 7-year journey, I've made so many mistakes in terms of learning unnecessary material, going over unnecessary languages, and doing a bunch of unnecessary stuff that has wasted a lot of time. And I want to make sure you all do not make the same dumb mistakes I did on my coding journey when you all are trying to learn how to code on your own. This way, you'll be able to learn more in a less amount of time, and that way, you may end up being the next Joe in tech, but cooler. And I can say that because I'm 90% sure that YouTube algorithm will not put this video in his feed. So the first thing I would do is I would pick one mainstream language and I would learn it. So when I first started coding, the first framework slash language I used to actually code anything was Corona SDK. Corona SDK.
What did he say?
And no, this does not have any relations with the alcohol company. This is a software development kit. Never drink and code. It's worse than drinking and driving, by the way. Corona SDK was a framework powered by a language called Lua, and I used it to build physics-based apps. And the first two games I built were some political related games where you have to click images of Donald Trump. And it was kind of interesting. They got 2,000 downloads. But the point is that I never used Lua in my life ever again. And the concepts I learned as I used Lua were too game program oriented that I could not apply the same concept to other things. Now, I'm not saying that I couldn't apply any of the knowledge I learned from Lua to my other languages, because at the end of the day, coding builds coding experience. So whether you're coding in the cut language or a mainstream language, if you're coding, you're building your experience. But if I could do it again, I would pick a mainstream language to start off with. And the language I would pick specifically either would be Python, Java, or Golang. And the reason I'm picking a mainstream language such as these is because they have tons of resources and examples and videos that you can use to guide you on your learning process. Because what if you're trying to learn multi-threading in Java? There's tons of videos, and a quick Google search will show you how to do it. I remember learning the language OCaml, and this was one of the most indie cut languages that I literally used for 2 months of my life, and that was for a school related thing. And I couldn't even go on Stack Overflow and find the answer to my questions. And if Stack Overflow, which is built for coding dummies who do not know, you know, how to, you know, solve the problem, it's good for lazy people like me. If Stack Overflow does not have your answers or anything remotely close, then you know there's a problem with that language. That language must be some language used by the cavemen. And if I had to give one specific language to pick, I would say Python, because it is the future. The next tip I will give all you Google engineers is to supplement every tutorial of a coding language or framework you're learning with a side project. I have spent hours watching tutorials on people coding, because when I first started, I was so enthralled by the idea of coding. I just wanted to see people create things, and I would just copy their code that they share in a YouTube video and do it on my own. Now the thing is, since I'm copying them, I'm not really learning, and most of the actual learning is in one ear and out the other. And the code, the best way to learn any language or framework is to actually do something hands-on by yourself. Yes, you can use videos to guide you, but you want to create something yourself. A nice, neat little side project that maybe can help you. For example, if you love music, you can create an MP3 player using Java. Or if you love to play video games, maybe you can create a nice physics-based app. Now, no one is asking you to make the next Yahoo or Apple Maps. Just make something basic. You can make a simple calculator console-based program in C# if you're learning C#. And at that point, you're already learning a lot of fundamental concepts that can help you in your coding journey. The best part about doing side projects and starting them early is you're able to document your progress as a programmer. And then when you're applying for maybe a job or a lead role, you can show as many side projects you've accumulated over the years that you've done, and they'll see your improvement as a programmer. And recruiters would love that. And personally, if I could go back, I would start side projects from the get-go. Like, obviously right now, as a college student, I'm aware that side projects are a big help on your resume. But if I was aware of this sooner, then I would have started sooner. But please, create those side projects, keep them simple. No one's asking to make next Tinder, so please do it. I don't know why Tinder came to my mind. Swipe right. The third tip I'll give you all is to mix front-end and back-end learning. When I first started coding, I specialized in front-end, so I learned HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. And with JavaScript, you're learning, you know, some back-end programming as well. But with front end, I would see the results of my program like right away, because if you create a H1 tag, like a title on a web page, you will see it right away, right when you refresh the browser. But I did front end so much that I got scared of back end development. I thought back end development was for, you know, super hackers or something. But the idea is that you can do front end and back end at the same time, and you should do it at the same time, because that way you can understand how, you know, full stack application works from the front end and the back end. And this is important content you need to know when you're applying for a job or in CS in general. On top of that, you will find out sooner whether you love backend development more or front end development more. And I found out that I love backend development more, and I found that out 3 years later. So it would have been nice if I learned that in the real beginning. And by the way, for those who do not know what backend development is, it's basically when you're coding stuff behind the scenes, like you're processing requests, while front end is more like the GUI, which what the user clicks, like the buttons, the text boxes. So you design all of that. And now another tip, and this tip, I'm sure you guys might brush aside. I definitely brush aside this thing when someone first told me this when I was younger, and that is to learn the coding jargon. You all need to know computer science terms. Like, you need to know TCP IP, HTTPS, IP addresses, what the parts of the computer are, what they do, how they help the computer, how they help the processors, all of that. For example, if you guys see my bot development videos, I create bots, and one thing we look at extensively is the CPU and the RAM usage. Because we can create a bot, but if our bot is destroying the RAM and CPU and having the entire CPU work for that bot, which is like 100% capacity, then your computer will blow up. And as a bot developer, I don't want to be sued by people because they're angry with, hey, I use your bot and my computer blew up. So understanding how RAM, CPU, and all those hardware side things work is very beneficial, and I highly recommend you all to learn that. I started learning the hardware side things very late, literally a year ago, which is beyond like late. So please be sure to be a full computer scientist and not just programmer focused. You want to learn about the computer itself because, like I said, you want to become the best computer scientist, okay? That's the goal. Not just a programmer, not just a hardware engineer. You want to be a computer scientist. Plus, when I was preparing for interviews, one of my mentors told me about a bunch of terms that I should know. And a lot of these terms were just general, you know, computer science terms that you should know. Some of these terms were like the STAR method, which Amazon uses for interviews, CDN, a bunch of things that I never knew what they meant until I researched them, and now I know. Now, these are the tips, but before I sign off, I have a very important message to all of you that want to embark or are already on the coding journey. The first thing, you do not need to spend tons of money on expensive courses to learn how to code. There's a bunch of free resources out there, like my Skillshare class, link in the description below, which teach you how to create, you know, an application that you can use personally and that you can learn from. Also, you do not have to love to code to be good at coding. Yes, this sounds really weird, but it is true. There are people out there who learn how to code for a means to an end. Some of them just learn how to code to create a website or an app that they sell or give to users for a ton of money. And then once they make that money, they're out to space. And that's perfectly fine. I know that sounds kind of cheap. And as an avid programmer, I would think, hey, that's a little cheap. You're a fake programmer. But there's no such thing as a fake programmer, guys. If you know how to code and you code something, you are officially a programmer. The last thing I want you all to know is that to be the best programmer you can possibly be in your entire lifetime, you have to like this video and subscribe. Peace.